While the commanders and starships of Star Wars are pretty widely known, less famous are the people responsible for creating those starships in-universe, despite their massive impact on the galaxy. Today we're going to be talking about one of the most important starship designers in galactic history, and his movement from the Republic to the Rebellion, Wallach Blissix. We don't know when exactly Wallach's career started, what his homeworld was, or even necessarily how to pronounce his name. But we do know at least two pre-Clone Wars designs made by him for Kuat Drive Yards, where he was the chief engineer for many years. The Delta 6 and Delta 7 starfighters, possibly earlier designs in that series as well. For these starfighters, he pulled on inspiration from designs much older, including the Oryx starfighter, which had been used in some capacity for nearly 4,000 years. In the updated Delta 7B, which is what Obi-Wan flies in Episode 2, he made some changes tailored towards Jedi pilots. He took those changes even further during the war with the introduction of a new class of fighter, built around extreme agility relying on the Jedi's precognitive abilities, the Ada II Actus Interceptor, which is what's used by Anakin and Obi-Wan in the opening scenes of Revenge of the Sith. While Kuat Drive Yards, or KDY, would be edged out by Wraith Senar's company, Senar Fleet Systems, in the design of Imperial fighters, the TIE series would take heavy inspiration from Wallach's work with the Ada II in particular. Notably, Wallach is stated as being unable to properly use computers and required assistance with that as well. So I'm not sure how that really worked with all of Star Wars using computers all the time. Maybe it means that he came from a more Outer Rim system and then was brought on for his talent to the more core-based Kuat Drive Yards. But even on kind of Outer Rim or fringe planets, computers seem pretty ubiquitous, so this would have been a pretty large hurdle for him to overcome. Throughout the Clone Wars, Wallach would work with multiple of the future Empire's top engineers when designing weapons of war, though he quickly became distressed with the state of the galaxy, and particularly the ties between the Republic War Ministries and his employer, Kuat Drive Yards. While he presumably had a hand in developing two of KDY's top ships heading into the war, the Venator and the Acclimator, these ships are typically attributed to his daughter Lyra, so she was probably the lead designer on the projects, and he may have had some input. His talents meant he was soon sought by the chief rival of KDY in their shipbuilding efforts, Rendili Star Drives. Rendili had, prior to the Clone Wars, maintained a position as arguably more prestigious than Kuat in Republic starship manufacturing. Thousands of years earlier, during the Jedi Civil War, and the Mandalorian Wars, and even some wars before then, they'd been responsible for most of the top starship designs. And in the lead-up to the Clone Wars, they were the creators of the very common Dreadnought-class heavy cruiser. With Wallach's doubts about KDY's goals, he proved a prime target for some corporate poaching, and he went to join Rendili. Rendili was just as eager to gain the important Republic contracts as Kuat, if not as successful, though. They often tried to use corporate espionage to steal KDY's designs, and to make their own ships based off of that, though we don't really have many examples of what ships those were exactly. Rendili had hoped that pulling in Wallach would stop KDY in their tracks, but the key designs had already been made and the contracts were already in place, so KDY didn't suffer that much from his departure. Furthermore, Wallach's daughter Lyra, who had worked alongside her father at KDY on the earlier designs we mentioned, remained upon his departure. She was, in a lot of ways, nearly as talented as her father and had none of his ethical qualms about the nature of the work, fashioning weapons of mass destruction. She did have some shortcomings compared to him in his starship design, which became a lot more evident on the Imperial-class Star Destroyer. She'll come up a bit in this video. I do plan to do a standalone video on her, though. The Republic was additionally concerned about Rendili's loyalty, especially with the preferential contracts going to KDY. In order to get around this, the Republic devised a joint contract between KDY and Rendili to develop a new class of ship intended for heavy ship-to-ship combat. This is something that was actually fairly different from the types of ships used so far in the Clone Wars. This was called the Victor Initiative Project. The result of this project was the iconic Victory Star Destroyer, which would see wide usage throughout both the Republic and the Empire. It was worked on by not just Wallach with Rendili, but also his daughter Lyra at KDY and many other prominent weapons developers, including Bevel Emlisk, who was later famous for being one of the Emperor's most prolific superweapon designers. Lemlisk would become proof of a saying quoted from Wallach: "Develop technology without wisdom or prudence, and your servant shall become your executioner." Unfortunately for Rendili, while the project accomplished many of its goals, there were significant splinters within their ranks, and many of the licensed Rendili shipyards joined the CIS. This, as much as anything else, solidified Rendili's second place spot after KDY in the future Empire ship production. According to the Essential Guide to Warfare, Rendili would instead be responsible for the less glamorous and profitable position of weapons platform developer. After the VSD, Wellick turned his attention back to starfighter design. He did provide at least one more capital ship to the Republic and Imperial forces, though. The Gladiator was designed by Wellick as an escort to the more powerful Victory, but never saw the same widespread use. On the starfighter front, he worked in some of the later stages of the war with future INCOM engineer Vorz Vorhorian from the Star Wars Kids magazine working on the new designs for some X-Wing and Y-Wing craft. Essential Guide to Warfare doesn't expand on the nature or timeline of that point since it's a bit early for the X-Wing, but it seems to largely have just been a weird side note to tie Vorz more directly into the universe's lore since he had just been in some kids magazine side stories. Wikipedia takes this passage from Essential Guide to Warfare and talks about it as if it's referring to the end of the Galactic Civil War, but the context makes even less sense there, and if you take it that way, it would imply that Wellick is working with KDY under the Rebels and then early New Republic, which doesn't really track with what we know he did later, or where Kuat was aligned to, or even when any of this stuff was introduced either. So I don't think that the Wikipedia information there is actually that accurate. And I'm honestly not sure what Essential Guide to Warfare is really going for directly. It's a kind of weird sentence either way. Beyond that, though, Wellick did develop two more starfighters for Kuat, whom he apparently worked with again throughout the war despite his leaving for Rendili. These were the Alpha 3 Nimbus Interceptor and the V-19 Torrent, aiming to correct what he saw as earlier mistakes with the Eta and the Delta classes. Following the end of the Clone Wars, Wellick had become completely disillusioned with the Republic's war effort, and he certainly held no love for the Emperor or the New Empire. He saw the risk that they represented for Galactic society and went into hiding, quickly joining forces with members of what would become the later leaders of the rebellion. His daughter Lyra, however, remained with the Empire and took his place within Kuat Drive Yards, playing a key role in developing ships that were used by the Empire, including the Imperial class and the Executor class. The timeline on the introduction of the Imperial class is incredibly variable, so that's definitely not a sequential series of events. Most timeframes for the introduction of the ISD do put it during the Clone Wars, so this would be before the departure of Wellick, though after his departure from KDY potentially, so there is still some room to maneuver there. Wellick's most famous contribution to the Rebel fleet was a joint venture between him and General Yondu Donna, the RZ-1 A-Wing Interceptor. This project was initially held back by a lack of funding from a skeptical Mon Mothma, but the lack of support resulted in the development of a highly capable starfighter using cheap and widely available parts. This fighter, which could challenge almost anything the Empire had to offer in an interceptor role, played a key role in many major Rebel victories throughout the late stages of the Galactic Civil War, including the Battle of Endor. There are a couple stories involving Wellick from this period that come out of Star Wars RPG sourcebooks, like Crisis on Cloud City, Starfall, and a comic called Entrenched. These are actually some of the first places that Wellick shows up, in a place where his character design significantly diverges from some later sources. But aside from Starfall, we won't touch on them too much. A lot of the events still fit within other sources, they're just a lot more personal because they're intended to be used for RPG adventures, which do often have a lot of useful information, but it's pretty niche for this stuff. In Starfall, however, Wellick gets contacted by his daughter's husband, Imperial Moff Den Wessex, saying that Lyra was dying and wanted to see him. Reconciliation with Lyra had been something that Wellick had always hoped for, so despite the misgivings of other Rebel leaders, Wellick made his way to the Imperial Victory Star Destroyer Subjugator. It had all been a trap set up by Lyra, who had not lived up to her father's reputation as a starship designer within the Imperials. While being held captive there, the Subjugator was attacked by the Rebel Task Force Starfall, a Nebulon B with four Corellian corvettes, unaware that Wellick and other Rebels were being held on the ship. Wellick was able to escape the ship along with his other Rebel escorts before the ship self-destructed. Lyra had also managed to escape, but Wellick was unaware of that, so he believed that she died with the ship. Crisis at Cloud City has another encounter with her father, but we'll save that for her own video. After returning to the Rebel fleet, Wellick continued in a leadership position within the Rebellion up until Endor, where he gets identified as a background character on the Home One in Return of the Jedi. After this, he largely retired from public life, until the return of Emperor Palpatine prompted other aging Rebel generals, including Yondu Donna, to come out of retirement in an advisory body known as the Grey Cadre. He'd also designed a follow-up to his Victory class during this period, the Republic class Star Destroyer, one of the weirdest looking ships in Star Wars. After Palpatine's final defeat, the Grey Cadre mostly returned to their retired lives, though they still met and gave advice to the New Republic on military matters on occasion. On a real-world note, while it's not a complete parallel, to me, Wallach's Blitzlix gives a bit of a J. Robert Oppenheimer feel, as far as his supposed distaste for the weapons he helped create afterwards. Oppenheimer was the head of the Los Alamos lab during the Manhattan Project, credited as one of the fathers of the atomic bomb, and probably most famous for quoting the Bhagavad Gita afterwards, saying, "Now I am become Death, the destroyer of worlds." After his role in the creation of the atomic bomb, Oppenheimer became heavily involved in non-proliferation efforts, and I do think the extra from Return of the Jedi later designated as Blitzlix even kind of looks like Oppenheimer. I don't think there was any intentionality behind this. Reluctant weapons manufacture isn't that rare of a trope, and there's a lot more to unpack with Oppenheimer, but it was just something that kind of jumped to mind while I was working on this video. Either way, that's going to do it for the video. The topic was requested by Polyworld on the Discord suggestions channel, so hopefully over the next little while I'll be able to make it through some more of those suggestions already made in the near future. If you have any suggestions you'd like to make, please leave them in the comments or post them in the suggestions channel on the Discord. I think this is also probably the longest video we've had in a while. If you've enjoyed, consider leaving a like or subscribing for more. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you next time.